So one thing we've done very cautiously in the marketing team is that we will not do something just because it's a fad.
So today, from everything that you all are doing on video, how much of its ROI or impact to begin with is it having? Because you have a very clear cut objective.
So we've done, like advertising works, the best mix is really 360.
Yes, yes. Yeah?
And very often when you do 360, it is very difficult to establish the effectiveness of each medium.
Yes, yes.
So what we've done is, so while we've also followed a few attribution models, etc., but as a company, we still believe more in last click. And as marketers, we know that every form of advertising will definitely impact another form of advertising, right? When we're on TV, it impacts search, our CTRs improve and so on. What we did was, and we continue to do that, is there are some markets where we go video only first and try and see, is it moving a metric or not? It might not move it as impactfully as maybe another another medium. Element in the mix would, and you would just kind of expect that from different elements, because it would not maybe move like a TV impact, but is the needle moving or not? Then the other way we look at it is also video enables you to actually serve different communication to people in different segments. So while you can now serve for the same product different messages to different people, which I think itself is very, very effective, because I can talk to people in different languages. So for example, in Jeevan Sathi, we've got a series of videos where, we follow different videos for the brand funnel. So if you want to create top of mind, it's a very different kind of
correct. The tonality is different.
Correct. How have we learnt it? We've also learnt it through experimenting. When we started out on our journey 6 years ago, we did what a lot of marketers did. You're creating this for TV, edit it and put it on YouTube or put it on another platform.
You're confessing to that.
But we've learnt it, through iterating. I won't say that we have big successes. We still have enough successes and we'd still continue to fail at some of them. But I think that's part of your learning curve,
So talking about video again, you've been experimenting as a brand, immense learnings, etc. What has been your take on user-generated content? Has that helped you build brand advocacy?
We haven't done too much in that area because it's not very, very easy to create UGC, right? Because if I have to create UGC, then I'm creating it, right? It's not really UGC, right? It's not coming organically. So a lot of us, I think, in marketing have done activations, which we have beautifully edited, created bite-sized, small videos, and used it on various social platforms. Some of us might have put money behind it. Some of the stuff is such that it's actually got shared itself, and therefore maybe not created a huge ripple, but got enough views and got shareability. I think it's the strength of the content. Definitely with UGC, what comes is credibility, and the moment I share it with my friends and they share it with their friends, you kind of get so much more credible viewership rather than viewership that you're forcing through a pre-roll or a micro ad on a video format.
How do you as a brand actually distinguish, the kind of content you want to leverage across platforms today? Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, or your own brand platforms. How do you kind of distinguish, create, customize? What is your approach to that?
So one thing we've done very cautiously in the marketing team is that we will not do something just because it's a fad,
Fair enough.
And therefore, we want to exploit the platform for what the ethos the platform derives. For example, if I'm on LinkedIn, then it's a little bit more. So it's not just B2B content, but it's a little bit more serious content. We won't do a Hari Sadhu kind of content on LinkedIn. And we are cautious of that. Do not create and broadcast to all the four social platforms. Create for each platform. So for Twitter, all we do generally on Twitter is we actually have a lot of trend reports that come out. In Naukri, we have a monthly JobSpeak index that actually talks and tracks about how jobs are growing in sectors, in cities across the country, month on month, you know. And we've been coming out with that index for a couple of years now. It has a lot of credibility. So every time we publish the index in media, we also do bite-sized tweets of it because it's content and people want to consume that there. We share that in Facebook in a very different format, which is one upload of a report, because Facebook audiences are in a different mindset. We use Facebook for the strength of the platform, which is the targeting that it gives us, because not a lot of other platforms can give you that kind of targeting. There, then we use a lot of advertising that we feel will be best suited. It could be carousel ads. It could be a video if required, you know, and we feel that, no, this will come best through a video. It could be a GIF ad. Similarly, Instagram is something that we use extensively only in 99acres and in Jeevansathi, because it's all to do with photos, etc. Right?
Very visual, yeah.
Yeah, it's very visual. So the two brands that a lot of visual content is there is actually properties, you know, and so real estate and Jeevansathi is the place where we use Instagram. So we are cautious that we will not use every platform on every brand just because it's good to use them. Right? We will use them if we can put them to proper use. So in Naukri, if I just have to create an image and put it on Instagram, there's no point just getting those shares and likes and just create images and putting there, unless I feel that this category really images and, you know, photos are going to really benefit people.